What is up, everybody? Welcome to episode 8 of the terrain rendering series. In the last couple of videos, we've been busy with Geomipmapping, an algorithm for continuous level of detail. You can find the playlist for the entire series in the video description below. Today I'd like to wrap up the discussion about Geomipmapping. The first video was an overview of the algorithm, and we talked about the change from a simple grid of triangles to a triangle fan. In the second video, we saw a solution to the problem of cracks in the terrain by maintaining all the possible permutations between the core of the patch and what we call the ring, which is the outer strip of triangles. We know that the crack problem is relevant only to the ring and not to the core, so we need to select the correct combination between the LOD of the core and the LOD of the ring on all four sides, based on the distance from the camera and the LOD of the patch neighbors. So we've created this data structure where every LOD has an element in this vector of LOD info structures, and the single LOD info structure has a start and a count. The start points to the beginning of the index buffer where this specific permutation starts, and then the count tells you how many indices we need to render for this combination. So the only question that remains is how to select the correct permutation for each patch, and this is the topic for today's video. The selection is done by an object called the LOD Manager. Okay, before we get started, I'd like to say a big thank you to Gabriel Betros, who recently joined the OpenGL Underground. If you too would like to support this channel, you can do that at patreon.com/OGLDEV or by joining the YouTube channel as a member. So in terms of the big picture of the classes, we have the GeomipGrid class, which maintains the vertex and index buffers for the actual grid of vertices on the GPU, as well as this data structure which we just saw with the vector of LOD info structures. And the GeomipGrid holds an instance of the LOD manager, which selects the correct permutation to be used when rendering, and this permutation inside this LOD info vector tells you exactly the segment of indices inside the index buffer that you need to render for this patch in the correct LOD for the core as well as the ring. In terms of the code, the LOD manager has its own class, and the main thing in this class is a two-dimensional array of patch LOD structures, and this structure tells you the LOD of the core and the four sides of the ring, so that when you call get patch LOD with the index of the patch on the X and on the Z, you get back the correct permutation that you need to use for rendering. The basic setup of the terrain is that it is divided into this grid of patches, and every patch, you know, has the LOD of the core and an LOD for the ring. And by default, the LODs are zeros, so if you just render it like that, you get the regular grid of triangles without any level of detail. Now let's say that the camera is located somewhere here, down here. The target is to select the proper LOD for each patch based on the distance of the patch from the camera. So for example, we may get LOD 0 for this group of patches, and then on this ring, we can get LOD 1, and then the rest are LOD 2. And so the question is, what about the rings? In the previous video, we saw that the ring must match itself to the core of the patch that it belongs to, but also to the neighboring patch if it is of a lower LOD. As we can see here, this patch is one LOD lower than this patch, so the ring here needs to match itself by skipping those vertices here and creating larger triangles compared to the rest of the patch down here. So the final step is to fix the LODs of the ring so that when we have two neighboring patches of the same LOD, as in this example right here, both are LOD 0, the ring on this side, on the right side of this patch and on the left side of this patch, will be the same, LOD 0. But in terms of the patches on the left and right hand side of this ring, which has LOD 1, we will fix the LOD to be one level lower for this side and also for this side up. Okay, so we have zeros here because these guys are zeros. And then we have one here because these guys are ones. And then the same happens on the outer, on the more distant side of the terrain, where everything here is LOD 2. So this row of patches must fix the LOD of this side of the ring to match those guys who are of LOD 2. Okay, so in terms of the responsibilities of the LOD manager, there are actually two of them. It needs to be able to calculate the maximum LOD. This is done based on the size of the patch, of course, and we only need to do this once when we bring up the system. And also, it needs to choose the correct LOD for each patch, for the core and for the four sides of the ring. And this is done, of course, based on the location of the camera. And we need to do this on every frame, right? Because the camera is dynamic, it is moving. So on one frame, you may get some combination of LODs. And then on the next frame or a few more frames into the future, the camera will be on a different location, so the LODs will be different for this patch and for other patches as well. Okay, let's talk about how we calculate the maximum LOD for a patch. And we already know that in LOD 0, the triangle fan is constructed from a subgrid of 3x3 vertices without skipping any vertices, you know, without any gaps between them. And we also have this requirement that the patch will be tessellated with full triangle fans. Okay, so in this example, this will work because we have 17 vertices here. Okay, so 16 segments. And this means that we can fit 8 triangle fans of this size. Along the row and also along the column. Okay, so a total of 64 triangle fans here. But if we subtract one column or row of vertices or add a column or a row of vertices, then what we'll get is kind of a half of a triangle fan. And while you can choose to support this, it adds a lot of corner cases. So I've decided to support only a case where I can fit full triangle fans without any remainder. Now in LOD1, the size of the triangle fan doubles. So we now have 4 segments over 4 segments or 5 over 5 vertices. And in this case, we have to skip some vertices, as you can see right here. And we still have the requirement of using only full triangle fans across the entire patch. And again, this works in this size because we can now tessellate it with 4 triangle fans along the row and also on the column. So we are still okay here. In the next LOD, LOD 2, we now have 9 vertices and 8 segments. And we are still okay, right? We can do 2 triangle fans on this row and on this column as well. So a total of 4 triangle fans, and this is fine. In LOD3, we have reached the maximum, and we can now do only a single triangle fan on the entire patch. So following this logic, it makes sense to support only patches where the number of segments in the patch is a power of 2. And this means that in the lowest LOD, we will always get 1 triangle fan on the entire patch. So the maximum LOD is simply the base 2 log of the patch size minus 1. The patch size is, of course, the number of vertices. So patch size minus 1 is the number of segments. Now, if you wish, you can, of course, support a wider range of patch sizes without this limitation, but this means that you will need to handle all those various corner cases, which will make your code much more complex. Okay, before we select the LOD for each patch, we need to decide about the ranges for the LOD. Okay, so from the camera up to some range, we have LOD 0, and then from this point to a more distant location, LOD1, and then LOD2, and etc. It's important to remember that the relevant range is only from the near Z up to the far Z, because anything outside of this range is clipped away. And so there's no point in setting up LODs beyond the far Z. To make it simpler, we will ignore the near Z and simply go from zero up to the far Z. Now, there are literally dozens and more different options for you to divide the range into the LODs. Just from the top of my head, I can offer two different options. One is to divide the range evenly between the LODs. This is very simple. And a bit more complex is the second option, where the range of LOD1 is twice the range of LOD0, and the range of LOD2 is three times the range of LOD0, and then etc. And this is actually the option that I've used in my implementation, which we can see in this function, calc LOD regions. We need to traverse all the LODs and then calculate their sum right here, and then divide the far Z by the sum. Okay, so this provides you the range for the first LOD, LOD0, and then you need to traverse up until the max LOD again. Don't forget the last one. And then for the current range, you just need to multiply this value by the current index. And this is stored in the M regions array, which is simply a vector of integers. Okay, so for each LOD, we have a corresponding range in this vector. And then to calculate the actual range, we need to subtract the range of the previous LOD, right? Because each LOD starts from the end of the previous LOD and then continues up until the value which corresponds to it in this vector. Now, during runtime, when we render the geomip grid, we need to traverse all the patches and ask the LOD manager what is the LOD for this patch based on its X and Z indices. And we get back this patch LOD structure, which we just saw, which tells us the LOD for the core and for the ring. And then we know where to start in the index buffer and how many elements we need to render. And so we can call GL draw elements base vertex correctly. We saw that in the previous episode, but the LOD manager needs to know the position of the camera, right? So before we do this traversal, we call the LOD manager and we provide it using the update function. We provide it the camera position. The update function decides on the actual LOD to be used for each patch. And the way that it does it is by doing two passes over all the patches. On the first pass, it calculates the LOD of the core based on the distance from the camera to the center of the patch. And on the second pass, it matches the LOD of the ring for every patch to the core LOD of its neighbors. So if the camera is right here, we calculate the distance from the camera to the center of each patch for everyone, including those ones over there and here. And then we set the core LOD for all the patches. Okay, so for example, in this case, we get zero here because it's the closest one, and then ones in this ring around, and then two for the rest. And then we set the LOD of the ring based on the neighboring patches. Okay, so for example, if we have zero here and one down there, we need to fix the bottom side of the ring to one on the higher LOD, and also actually on all four sides, because all of them are ones. And then this patch needs to fix the left-hand side to be two, to match this this patch right here. And then, as you can see, for the entire terrain. And the code itself is also very simple. We can see those two passes inside the update function. Okay, so for the first pass, we traverse all the patches, we calculate the center of the patch, we calculate the distance from the camera to the patch center, And then we map this distance to the corresponding LOD based on the vector of ranges that we just talked about. So now we can get the patch LOD structure for this patch and set the LOD, the core LOD, for what we've got for this distance. And then on the second pass, we do another traversal of all the patches, and we now get the core LOD, which was set in the previous pass. And then we check based on the location of the patch, whether we can go left, right, top and bottom. And then we check for each neighboring patch, whether it is of a lower LOD than the current patch. And if this is the case, we set the left side of the LOD of the ring of the current patch to be 1. Otherwise it is 0. And when we set 0 here, it means that this side of the patch is the same LOD as the core. If it is 1, we need to add 1 LOD to this side of the patch. Okay, so for the left, right, top and bottom, we do the same thing. And then finally, everything is updated correctly. Okay, so let's run this. And as you can see, we have a higher LOD right here and then lower LODs in the distance. And as we go back, more patches are dropping in their LOD. And if we move forward, we're getting more detail as we move closer to the terrain, as expected. Now you may be wondering, what about the target vector of the camera? Because we can actually drop patches that are behind the viewer, or you know, too much to the left or the right hand side, so that they are outside of what we call the view frustum. And this is actually an excellent question. So in the next video, we will see a general algorithm to do frustum culling, which is not dependent on geomipmapping or the LOD manager. So that's it for today. If you enjoyed this video, please hit the like button and subscribe. Thank you for watching, and I hope to see you in the next episode of Terrain Rendering.